Capitalism is one of the more vexed concepts that one can use. I mean, I start with actually a very, what I think is a commonsensical assumption, is that if we're talking about capitalism, we have to talk about capital, and we need a definition of what capital is. Economists debate that a lot. The definition I use in the book, I think, is also quite simple, which is capital is a form of property. It's a legal asset that generates a future profit. It's legal, so it has to have owners. So if you're going to have capital, you have to have capitalists. And the kind of broader motion in the economy, but also, as you suggested in your opening remark, motion outside of the economy as such, politics, culture, that generates profits out of capital, you know, that process, that system, I think is what makes for a capitalist economy at large, is what makes for capitalism.
How much is the concept of exploitation intrinsic to that, right? Because capital is not just property. Property is property. It's mm-hmm. the way that and how much also is the relationship with labor. I mean, it's easier to conceptualize, I guess, when you're talking about slaves in capitalism, because that was literally slaves were literally property. Ostensibly, your workers are not their property. They're, I guess, selling you the property of their labor, I guess, on some level. But how much of that is necessitates exploitation, right? Because you can't pay for, can't pay what the labor is worth necessarily, or you wouldn't really have a business.
Yeah, I mean, so there's a couple of things going on here. So first, typically, understandings of capitalism that point towards labor exploitation as being really fundamental, really being central, tend to be broadly within a Marxist camp. You know, Marx emphasized that the source of profits, the source of surplus value, as he called it, you know, must always be the exploitation of labor. My view is somewhat different. Now, you know, you could juxtapose that to a view that's very typical in mainstream economics today, which is to suggest that profit comes from entrepreneurship, it comes from risk-taking, it comes from equal exchange. It never comes from labor exploitation. My view, I suppose, is somewhat, I don't want to say in the middle, because the middle view is typically wrong. Certainly, there's a lot of profit-making in a capitalist economy that comes from labor exploitation. You could look at the way that workers are forced often in large corporations to work overtime without being compensated, without being paid. That's a source of profits. You mentioned in the past slavery, which is obviously nothing but a system of labor exploitation, and the extent to which slavery was a capitalist economy, and very much it was in U.S. history, labor exploitation is key. But I don't subscribe to the view that labor exploitation is always the source of profits. I think it's very hard to actually make that work when you study the economy. There are other ways to do it. Perhaps innovation and entrepreneurship might be a source of profitability. You know, today, if you want to look at profits, you have to look at monopoly, right? You have to look at the control of markets and the way competition is undermined by the concentration of power, concentration of market power. That might not be exploitation, but it also might be a phenomenon that we don't particularly like, either economically or politically or ethically. That can explain where profits come from. So I think historically, you know, you have to have a theory of capitalism, you're right, to frame the subject. But one of the nice things about history, I think, of course, I'm a historian, is the richness of the subject matter can allow you to be flexible. And depending upon, you know, where you're looking, the time and place, to identify all kinds of sources of profit that drive, you know, capitalism forward. But you're certainly right to point to the labor exploitation issue. It's absolutely central.
Okay, and we will get back to those questions of monopoly as we get to the fourth. You essentially have four eras in which the capitalism within this country has mutated or changed relative to, I guess, the circumstances and the innovation and whatnot. So let's start. Let me just touch on one more thing that you deal with early on. You talk about the importance of different types of liquidity. Can you walk us through, you know, what that means and what the different types of liquidity are that we see throughout the course of the 400 years or some odd 350 years of American capitalism?
Yeah, so my book, we've been talking about the kind of big picture issues and these definitional questions. You know, my book is mostly inspired in this respect by Keynes, by the British economist John Maynard Keynes, which often, you know, Keynes is read as a kind of centrist. I think actually Keynes's economic vision was much, much further to the left than is typically realized. And my book is part of other attempts to kind of develop a left social democratic Keynesian vision of what capitalism is and how it works. And absolutely central to that is this issue of liquidity and liquidity preference. Liquidity is a bit of a technical term, but it's not that difficult. You know, a liquid asset for Keynes is one that stores value over time. In a capitalist economy, that's money. So liquidity preference means that owners of wealth, owners of capital, prefer to hoard money as opposed to investing long-term in production, enterprise, employment, and labor, potentially labor exploitation, to go back to the earlier point in our conversation. Keynes also theorizes that all things being equal, owners of wealth prefer liquidity, right? They want to hoard their wealth. They don't want to invest long-term. And the central dynamic of capitalism in this view is the contest between long-term investment, which leads to production, creates economic potential, creates economic possibility, and hoarding behaviors. Keynes pointed to two. First, hoarding cash. Like lots of corporations today just sit on cash. They don't invest it. They don't spend it. It's wasted. Second, and this is a little bit counterintuitive, Keynes also thought of speculation, short-term speculation, as being a kind of hoarding. So instead of committing to the future long-term and creating new economic futures, momentary speculation, it looks like a lot's happening. It looks like energetic, but it actually produces nothing. If we think of kind of stock market booms that are exciting, right? Prices go up, people make money, but they don't generate much in their wake. And so to me, that contest between the short-term hoarding behaviors, which is what capitalists want to do, right? They actually don't want to invest in our futures, and usually political initiatives, oftentimes coming from the state, oftentimes coming from the way that working people contest the ownership of capital, they could push investment. The investment, I think, being the central dynamic in a capitalist economy, can push investment towards the long term and can create new economic futures. So that's where, you know, that's where liquidity comes into the picture.
And I just also want, as we go through this, for people to just note when that dynamic shifts over the course of the history that you lay out, where and we should say that hoarding could also be just sort of, you know, sort of like dynasties, you know, like yep. You know, like the Gates Foundation, you know, the whole Gates enterprise and whatnot.
Yeah, inheritance of wealth.
Exactly. And it's just, it is the cash stores, if you will, or the near cash stores that are being hoarded because ostensibly, I don't know, you know, you never know. Like maybe somebody comes out with a really neat new car that you need to buy. And that's why, or a neat new, rocket. And so you can go to the moon. You want to have that cash in hand to be able to drop that. But that dynamic changes too over the course of our history, relative to like sort of the way that society will allow for that type of hoarding or not.